because she was doing cyborg camps and I was running transhumanist discussion groups. And she has co-founded GeoLoki, which has then been acquired by Esri and is now at the Esri R&D department in Portland, Oregon. She speaks at all sorts of places, including TED. And I did not know this. You were the National Geographic's Emerging Explorer and magazine 30 Under 30, Inks magazine. I don't know these things. Did I hit everything? Ah, Case is a proponent of data ownership and uses her domain as her own personal data storage and identity provider. She founded Indie Webcamp with Tantec and Aaron over here, Aaron, in 2010. Yay! And that happens on Saturday and Sunday. You all should go. And yeah, furthering ideas of calm technology, wearable computing, and the future of interfaces. She's on Twitter as Case Organic.
All right, hello everyone. I'm going to talk to you about cyborgs and calm technology. So the first thing I'd like to tell you is that we're all cyborgs, and that doesn't mean that you're Terminator or RoboCop. You don't have to have anything implanted in your bodies in order to be a cyborg. In fact, everyone's a cyborg simply when they use a computer. They use a piece of technology that's external to them that stores some sort of information outside of themselves. So you could consider people making cave paintings or using early tools to be cyborgs because we've evolved in a symbiotic relationship between us and technology. Technology produces us and we produce it. And it's allowed us to have longer lifespans and really terraform our own worlds and change our environments. Because people are very strange. They put these kind of external prosthetics on themselves in order to adapt to new environments. Like a scuba diver can go underneath the ocean where a human shouldn't be able to go because they can attach these new tools to themselves. So in terms of tools, are the physical extensions of ourselves, like a hammer being the physical extension of a fist, is this thing that's external to us, that's a pretty stable object. For thousands of years, it's looked the same, felt the same, acted the same, had the same function. We can tell from its form what it does. But when we look at computing technology, it's an extension of both our physical self and our mental self. And the form doesn't match up with function. If you were to walk somebody into an old computer station and say, "What's this?" they would say, "I have no idea." And the same with this. What about this form actually says what it does? It's a sort of thing that's becoming more and more invisible, becoming smaller. The shape of technology that's an extension of our mental self is unstable inherently. So it's very interesting for me to study the creation of this idea of cyborg from a 1960 paper on space travel, which talked about the idea of adding all of these exogenous components to yourself in order to adapt to space, which is an inherently hostile environment. So the idea of a field of cyborg anthropology actually got founded in 1993 at a conference. They were talking about how we need to talk about our technology as actors in an actor network, as a system that acts alongside us. Donna Haraway, who wrote the Cyborg Manifesto, talks about non-human allies that can be animals or they can be creatures. And we now have these strange devices that cry and we have to pick them up and soothe them back to sleep. They get hungry and we have to plug them into the wall at night. If we keep them for too long, they turn against us and they fill our world with ill-fitting prosthetics. Sigmund Freud wrote this book called Civilization and Its Discontents, and he said we might have a future in which it is filled with these ill-fitting prosthetics that turn against us because they're not very well designed. It's because of all these things that I got into user experience design, not only for the physical world, but the digital world, because it's not necessarily about making an interface that looks really nice. It's about making the simplest interface that gets the job done. And as I was doing my research, I started to look at, okay, what's going to happen when there's all of these devices? This is a really often cited quote, that 50 billion devices will be online by 2020. And it's usually in this very incredibly excited context. We're going to have all these computers. How exciting. Does this sound really great? Well, then I thought about it and I said, well, if technology right now is really obnoxious and annoying and giving us blue screens and spinning beach balls of death and going out when we don't actually need it to, turn off or having some interface that didn't get updated correctly, then what's going to happen when we're surrounded by 50 billion of them? That's the fear that I have, is that we're not going to live in a dystopia, but as my friend Vin came up with, more of a mild dystopia, in which we don't necessarily have dystopian conditions all the time or utopian conditions all of the time. We have just enough annoyance that it makes our lives, there's this kind of friction to it, right? So let's consider some of the things that have come up. So the smart watch that gives you lots and lots of notifications about pretty much everything. That could be good in some situations. It's not inherently good. It depends on the design of the technology that gives you the notification. Or the smart fridge. For instance, I don't need to know whether the banana in my fridge is expired because the peel on the banana has been naturally evolving to tell me that it's expired by turning a different color. Also, the packaging is biodegradable and I can unwrap it. It's a really smart piece of technology. Technically, the packaging has been embedded into the banana or any of the other things in my fridge. Do I need to get reminded every time I go to the store to pick up the milk? Do I really need to do that? Or do I put that into a system in my mind that says every time I go to the store, I pick up the milk? Do I want to say, sorry, the virus updates must be downloaded on your fridge before you can open the door? You need to add a preferred plan to have other family members open the fridge. Oh, it looks like you're off your diet, and therefore you can't eat this sugar. Well, what happens if I'm about to have, if I'm about to pass out and I actually need sugar and my fridge locks me up because it's not according to my program? When the machine makes these decisions for you, you get into these strange traps where suddenly there's a million more parts to think about and a million more parts to service than just a basic fridge, which is why a lot of people have just been getting like older model fridges, because they just want a latch that opens the door and they can put their stuff in and they don't have to worry about all the extra features. However, in some countries, the more features that you have on your technology, the more exciting it is. And some people even have like washers and dryers that go, your laundry is ready, which is really difficult to hear because machines shouldn't talk like humans. You know, the Roomba does a really good job where it just goes da-da when it's done, and when it gets stuck, it goes dun-dun. That's it. That's all you need to know, right, as a status, or a tea kettle. So if you put all these things together, I really just imagine a dystopian kitchen of the future in which competing companies have all their different protocols, all their different data sets, they own all the different data about you, they all speak in different languages, they all give you different alerts, and then suddenly one day your entire kitchen is starting to beep at you in different ways, but you don't know how to disrupt the beeping and turn it off, and it's just this kind of dystopian environment. Because, you know, this is, you know, how many standards are there going to be about kitchen notification? And do you really need all of this kitchen notification? Do you really need all of these, you know, it's very easy to write about this sort of thing, but when it gets into reality, it can get very difficult. So I kind of think that we already are in this era of interruptive technology, and this will only increase over time unless we learn different ways to calmly notify people of certain things. And so really what I think we need is this idea of a calm technology, a technology that gets out of the way when you don't need it and is there when you do, makes you in calms and informs you instead of taking you out of your day and causing you to pay a bunch of attention to it, right? It shouldn't be like a small puppy, although a small puppy is cute and that would be okay. It should be more like something that's just always there. So calm technology came from a paper out of Xerox PARC in the mid-90s. So Mark Weiser, who's no longer with us, and John Seely Brown said, well, we're going to make the future in a small space at PARC, and then we're going to see what's going to happen. And Mark Weiser and John Seely Brown said, well, when we have all these devices, we need to make them in a way that they don't really interrupt everybody. So they came up with this idea of calm technology. And when I went back and looked at what they wrote, I said, okay, well, they wrote in an era in which there wasn't a ton of technology around. Now that we're increasingly having a lot of technology, we need to bring back this term and this narrative and this structure and these guidelines in order to at least help people to, you know, you as a designer or a developer can understand inherently that this might be a good thing, but you also need a way to convince the stakeholders in your company that are trying to add like 10 or 20 features in without understanding the consequences. So this is what I'm trying to do. This is a really great paper if you want to read it. It's on calmtechnology.com. It's called The Coming Age of Calm Technology, and it talks about all the different eras of technology and notification systems that we can have. So some of the quotes out of the paper. Technology shouldn't require all of our attention, just some of it, and only when necessary. And then there's a number of examples. This is my favorite one about empowering the periphery. As humans, we have great peripheral vision. We can see and sense things that are external to us. We can hear sounds that are far away without having to attune our entire head towards them. And so calm technology makes use of this peripheral attention. So we can be aware of these things, but we don't have the cognitive overhead of having to switch our focus entirely to them. So it's kind of like a fractal sense of perception. What can you fold into this smaller space to your side? How low of resolution can you go and also deliver the same quality and same resolution of information that you could with, say, a text alert? This is the question and the challenge of calm technology, because once you do that, then you have calming and informing technology that's reasonable to use, that doesn't annoy people constantly. So the idea of a calm technology, it can move easily from the foreground to the background. So you can place these things in the periphery, and then people can suddenly attune to 5 or 6 channels of technology, right? So you could say, I could attune my own perception, because it's really low resolution compressed, to 5 or 6 different channels. So I could know inherently what's going on in all these different places without having to place my attention on them one at a time. So it's kind of a way of calm multitasking, because multitasking is not really a great thing to do. But if you can compress it, you can probably multitask reasonably well. So let's look at some examples. My favorite example is a tea kettle. A tea kettle, you put water in, you set it, you forget it, and when it's ready, it draws attention to itself by its own power, by the steam going through the channel that says, yeah. So when you're in a different room, you can tell when the tea kettle needs attention, and then you go and get it. Right? So it's calm for most of the time, and then when you need to pick it up, it's no longer calm, and then right? You know exactly what it does. It has its own frequency or chirp. You know what a tea kettle is. People can make an imitation of a tea kettle, and it pretty much sounds the same across all tea kettles, except for the digital tea kettles, but people still know those. Right? A tea kettle is never, hey, I'm done, come and pick this up. Or it doesn't have like a beep, beep, beep. Right? So really, the whole point of this is that a little bit of technology goes the longest way. If you can figure out the lowest resolution of technology to solve your problem, you're going to have a lot less issues to solve and fix and maintain and support, and support in some weird language that's a new language that no one uses yet or might not use in another year or two. This is my other favorite one, toilet occupied sign. If I take my glasses off and everything becomes fuzzy, I can still look up and see whether it's green or red. You don't have to translate this software into 50 different languages. It's inherently known that that's a toilet and it's either occupied or not. This is really, really simple. And then it lights up or doesn't. Could you imagine a non-calm version of this? If it were to be designed today, it would send you a push notification on your phone that said, the toilet is open, the toilet is closed, the toilet is open. And it would have all these beeps, and you'd get like email updates about network with your toilet because it's exciting. You know, this is a brand of toilet, right? This is really simple. I like this light-based data system. So this was built by Aaron. He just made this simple system where there's some lights. This is a service called BeeMinder where you track your progress, and if you go off track, they take your money. So say if you want to lose weight by like not eating bread, every day you don't eat bread, you're on track. But if you eat bread one day, then you're off track. And so this system will like turn to yellow if you need to attend to it, or red if you need to attend to it right away. So then you don't have to go into the app and say, do I need to attend to this thing? You just inherently walk into your dining room, wherever you place the system, and say, oh, it's green. Well, I don't need to do anything. I only need to take action when it's yellow or red. And that way you don't have to open up your computer, get distracted by Facebook or Reddit or whatever, and then you can just go away. Taking this further, after seeing a talk, Aaron made this weather status lighting system using a Philips Hue. And the idea is that when you wake up in the morning, you can see what weather it is, you can just feel what weather it's going to be for the day. It takes the weather forecast and turns it into a light status. So if it's going to be sunny, it's yellow. If it's going to rain, it's blue. If it's going to be cloudy, it's kind of gray. And then you inherently know what it's going to be just by walking in. You don't have to look at the, you know, there's always these videos about somebody living alone in this perfect futuristic world, and they have the perfect San Franciscan like accent that can talk to all of the voice recognition apps and have them hear them clearly. and it's always quiet, and there's never any trucks driving by, so there's never any need to re-enunciate something because there's ambient noise. They don't listen to any music in the morning that might confuse the voice recognition apps that are always listening for their voices about talking about, tell me the weather, you know, or, you know, when you're brushing your teeth, having this big, beautiful weather display that is really beautiful but doesn't give you any information. This immediately gives you information by walking into your kitchen, and that's all it does. So a little bit about designing calm technology. The two principles that I went over before: a technology should inform while also in calming, and make use of the peripheral vision, the kind of fractal space to the side of you that you can compress things into while not giving people interruptions. If you design for people first, then with people in mind, actually using your stuff with paper prototypes and cardboard prototypes and real people, then you get rid of this idea that humans, well, the problem is when you design something that's not human first, you end up with situations where a human is put on pause, where a human is waiting for information, a human is acting like a machine. If you design for a human first, you amplify the best of humans, you amplify the best of what machines can do, and then they meet in the middle. And then you don't have to get a washing machine that says, ding, 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 I'm done, in some weird language that then you have to translate into a bunch of different languages. You just have that da-da, and then that's clear. Like kind of a lower level device language for machines. So the last part is that technology can communicate, but it really doesn't need to speak. So again, with a Roomba, it goes da-da when it's done, and it goes dun-dun if it's stuck. The funny thing about this vacuum, and it doesn't make decisions for you, when it gets stuck, it says, oh no, and then you go and pick it up and put it somewhere else. So you can always, as a human, say, oh, well, the machine isn't making all these decisions for me. I can pick it up because it's lightweight and move it where I need to put it. This posture sensor just sends you a little buzz when you need to sit straight, calmly informing you of what you need to do without sending you a text message that says, straighten your back. Sleep cycle is really great because you can just set this as an alarm clock, put it underneath your pillow. It will monitor your REM cycle and then wake you up right before you go back into deep sleep at a really nice time. So this is a way to just wake up naturally without having to track all of these things. So if you think about designing things not just for sending somebody a text message, but through all your different senses, you have a lot of different senses that you can compress notifications into. You can have auditory alerts, you can have haptic or you know, buzzing alerts, you can have light statuses instead of a full display. The easiest one to think about is the record button on a VHS. It's red, it's recording, it's really simple, it's universal. Positive or negative tones instead of there was an error. Just saying a dun-dun is really simple, like in video games. And then transparency. One example that Mark Weiser and John Seely Brown had was these inner office windows. They're a window up on the top of your office, so you still maintain privacy, but people can tell whether your light is on or off, and whether you're in the office or not, so they don't have to bother you as much. The Jawbone Up allows sleep tracking, but doesn't really have an interface too much. You can press it and it'll give you like a green status or a red status, especially when it's running out of battery. Makes a really good use of haptics and light. The Livewire was made by Natalie Germanenko. Mark Weiser was her advisor. This was an interesting device because it took something that was formerly invisible, like network traffic, and it made it visible. So whenever there was a lot of network traffic at park, it would start to go, and you could see what was going on. Ooh, somebody's doing something interesting. At this point, I guess people would be torrenting, and so it would be always going. But this early on was a kind of interesting indicator of network activity. So in terms of privacy, we can say, you know, what really is privacy? You could say in a serious tone that, you know, part of this is you need to be able to, it's not necessarily the device making decisions for you all of the time, but it is giving you some status based on something that knows about you often, right? And so privacy in some respects, I like this definition, the ability to have control over where your content goes and who it's accessed by. But my other favorite definition is that, you know, it can give you a feeling or perception of security, which is one of the issues. My favorite example is, in Second Life, there was a bunch of scammers that made banks in Second Life, and they looked like beautiful banks with marble columns. They were very impressive. So people would walk in these banks, deposit their money, hook up their bank account, and then get all of their money stolen. And when the Second Life security person asked them about them, people said, well, it looked like an impressive bank. It gave me a sense of trust, a sense of security. I said, well, did you know it's a virtual environment? You can just arbitrarily create something that looks trustworthy, and you can arbitrarily create something that's trustworthy online. So this perception of security can be completely designed. An example in a busing system, there were a bunch of security cameras put in, but only one in five buses actually got the security camera. Every bus actually just got a wine dark opacity, you know, surveillance camera shell. But the crime and the bullying on the buses severely decreased because people had this sense that they were being watched. Steve Mann, who did a lot of work here, made an experiment called Maybe Cam, where you may or may not be being surveilled by his t-shirt. And that really changed people's behavior around him. This is my favorite, that privacy is just the ability not to be surprised. People don't want to be surprised. It's as simple as that. And so if you can design systems in which people are not surprised and don't have to deal with your interface all the time, then you have a better system. So if you want to design for privacy, you could do privacy by design by allowing people to export their data. We can talk way more about that at Indie Web Camp. Don't have to go into it. Or data ownership, where people have access to their data. Contextual privacy, when you share something, being able to expose privacy controls at the point of posting. You don't want to give people all of this data that they don't need unless they're actually doing something with the device. And so again, you know, half of it's perceived, part of it's socially created. It depends on the norms of the world in which you're in, what people will feel comfortable with. So the norm for a while was feature phones. And then when camera phones showed up, people were terrified. They said, oh no, everybody's going to take pictures of everyone all of the time. What happened over time was that people got used to everybody having a camera phone in their pocket. We all have cameras in our pockets right now, and we're not terrified of each other as much as we could be, and especially as much as we were when they first started coming out. They had limited features, they had few apps, and then Google Glass came out. The issue was that it didn't come out for everybody all at the same time, so people started getting freaked out because the norm was we had camera phones in our pocket and we had these social rituals of pulling out the camera and taking a picture. So when this came out, not everybody had it. There was a design and product launch in which not everyone could create software for it. So when the iPhone first came out, there was lots and lots of stuff you could build with it and people were playing and people weren't playing with this system. So people didn't get a chance to play with it. There was a lot of confusion, there were too many features, and there was fear. And I made this little graphic of, most people asked, are you recording me right now? Because while there was video camera capability, there wasn't an indicator light to say whether somebody was recording. There wasn't that piece of calm technology that allowed people to understand whether there was a status of something going on or not. Whereas with the iPhone, there were small features iteratively added to the device over time in a way that it was cheap enough to actually build things with. And a lot of people had phones already and they knew what they did. So I tried to calm the device by headbanding it when I went into a place, like taking off a hat for in terms of politeness. But it never really made people feel comfortable because this is a very intimate part of your experiences, your eyes. And having something be between your eyes and somebody else's eyes is difficult. Now, if this were spread across 5 years and iterative products that were cheap enough, this could be embedded into reality. But unlike the smartphone, it wasn't launched in the same way. And so it wasn't a calm device. It wasn't designed, even though it was designed to look nice, it wasn't designed to be calm. And therefore, it panicked people. Whereas the narrative device, which is based on a long understanding of life logging, is a calmer device. It actually is pervasively taking pictures of people, but it's doing it for a personal time lapse. The camera is off to the side, up in the right-hand corner, or down in the corner, depends on where you put it on. And the shape is friendly, and it's not at eye level, and it doesn't sync constantly to the web. So it's a more calmer version, actually designed with the principles of calm technology by a guy in Sweden. So the idea of really good design really just allows people to get their goals done really fast, and the technology just gets out of the way, where people just don't even notice the technology is there. Like a good book is, well, there's two pieces of interface going on with a good book. One is the pages and the form of the book, which loads instantaneously and doesn't require any battery life and is stable for a couple hundred years. And then the writer's words, which are their own interface that allow you to slip into it. And so a great book allows you to dissolve into the interface. And a great piece of technology allows you to just become one with it temporarily and then come back out in a calm fashion. And the idea of calm technology is also, you can accomplish these same goals with the least amount of mental cost, because there's so many things now that are taking up our mental space that we often have, you know, if we have 100% of our mental capacity for the day, we often have like 200% more, you know, notifications and things that are drawing our attention. The more we can compress those, it'd be nice to have a day where we only had, you know, 50% of our cognitive capability taken up by technology, or 25%, because it was compressed in a way that we could handle all of it and we felt calm at the end of the day. So in conclusion, I think that a person's primary task should be being human and not being a computer and not having to always look at the technology. And the same, a computer's primary task should not be to try to be human and try to understand us. It should be connecting us to each other and our knowledge and our data in an efficient way and be designed to be smooth. So if you want to read more about this, there's calmtechnology.com. And that's it. So thank you so much.
This is a little bit of a general question. I would just really like to hear what your thoughts are on user experience design over the last couple of years and trends, because I've been designing interfaces for over a decade and I've seen a lot of changes in the last few years. Do you have any thoughts on UX culture and maybe if you could just share those really quickly. I think you...
Sure. So the question is about changes in UX over time. Yeah, the exciting thing is that when I first got into UX design, I didn't know what it was and that it was a legitimate field that you didn't have to go and get a four-year degree for. Somebody told me, hey, you're a UX designer because you have a physiological reaction to a button being in the wrong place, where like... it makes you angry and frustrated and you know, just almost kind of violent, you know, looking at like a parking ticket machine and then just bristling in anger, right? Where I think that before it was go and get a degree and in you know, human factors, you know, or human user experience, and write a bunch of research papers. And a lot of those that came out were really helpful, like the idea that I keep telling people, you know, where there's a larger iPhone format, and they're like, we want to put this button that people will use all the time over on the right-hand corner. And I said, well, then you can't use the app with one hand. You have to use both hands, you know. So I think on the one hand, there's a bunch of stuff from academic research that's extremely useful in the terms of user experience design that, you know, should be built into some guidelines that people can have at their fingertips, you know, in a kind of brief. And on the other hand, that limits people from really experimenting and doing new things. And I think now with like the rise of JavaScript, that people can really prototype stuff quickly and determine what they want. But on the other hand, there's this kind of uniform user experience that everybody's using constantly. So unlike the early web, where you're just experimenting with that whatever you wanted, we kind of have these standards that are arriving. And some of them are really good, and some of them are limiting. I like the idea that I can say user experience and people know about it now, and that there's conferences that support it. But on the other hand, we're still stuck with a lot of bad user interfaces. And I think it's just kind of like the fashion industry. There's going to be some people that lead it, and then there's going to be a bunch of copycats that do something that looks like it's good. Like there's a lot of beautiful like infographics and a lot of beautiful user experience that isn't necessarily usable. It looks good, and that tricks people into thinking that it's good, when in reality, it's not usable. In fact, I always point to Craigslist as something that's super usable because it works on an old computer, it works on a crappy browser, it works on your mobile phone. Anybody can use it, it has low bandwidth, right? Or like in China, there's WeChat, which was built originally on IRC for really low bandwidth conditions. So I think I hope there might be a shift to things that don't load 3 megabytes of JavaScript in the browser and like have good user experience and load the data first. But we're always going to run through these waves of it's crappy, it's okay, it's crappy, it's okay. And there's always going to be, you know, maybe 10% of the apps out there that are going to be reasonably good, and then a bunch of people who build things that aren't that good. And that's just human nature. So I kind of think of it like a bunch of different animals and species that are competing with each other in new and weird environments. And thankfully, we as humans can decide which technology we want to use sometimes, until we get trapped into things like, you know, Facebook, where the user experience changes on us and we don't have any control over that, versus building our own websites. So that's a long and squirrely answer. I hope that answers your question a little bit. You need to. Yeah.
Oh no.
It's a short question. So I would like to ask, what is the degree of association between calm technology and invisible technology?
Okay. So the question about calm and invisible technology. So there's this idea with invisible technology that technology is completely unseen, which is interesting if you think about, okay, we're going to put little sensors everywhere in the city, and then we're going to monitor toxicity levels. The best thing to do is take somebody's phone that already has those sensors and have it run an app that just records these levels, or have people, you know, set something on their phone. The issue with invisible technology is that it's more of a binary at that point, where it's like technology should be completely invisible, right? It's like no, we need moderation in technology. It doesn't need to be completely invisible. It should be invisible sometimes, and it should be communicative sometimes. And there's some cases in which you need to take something that's invisible and make it visible. So just saying I take some responsibility for this, because there was a talk that I gave that talked about the interface should be invisible and you should be able to walk into this invisible button and it should give you information, which I apologize for. It's not necessarily that it should always be invisible, but sometimes it can be, where you can make a boundary that's invisible. You can make a piece of technology that's somewhat invisible, but it needs to be in moderation. So calm technology is about saying, here's the times in which it can be invisible. Here's the times in which it should be loud, like a tea kettle shouting at you when it's an emergency. And then here's the times in which, you know, it should be this other thing with audio. And so I think it's more encompassing of the whole spectrum of technology than just these little tiny pieces where we have people who've come up and say, hey, it should be invisible, or no, it should be ubiquitous, or no, it should be this. So I tried to go all the way back in time and say, who has talked about something that's like a holistic perspective instead of just these little tiny points in the dark? And so that's why I think it's more encompassing. So thanks for your question. Okay, and I won't be long form.
Okay, so I'm a biologist, and from a biology point of view, from a Darwinian point of view, the more we adapt, the more we survive, and that's how we've survived for so long. If we continue being humans and just follow the same old user interface that we've been following, take standards, would that make us loser adaptation? Don't we actually need to keep adapting to newer technology and incorporate it rather than just accept what we are?
This is a good question. First off, I think we need to... Okay.
Sorry.
I'll store that in random.
I'm compulsive about time, so I'm going to... Sorry. Okay.
This is a completely unrelated question. So is calm technology really necessary? Because, for example, we see Apple products against Android, and some people just hate Apple products because they're too simplistic, and they want to have more control. So even if the user's experience is a little bit better, a little bit simpler to use, some people still want to go to command prompt and just to type and have exactly what they want. So I remember people with when the VCRs were selling and features were about programming VCRs and the more complex, the more expensive it is, but most people couldn't use it, but it was still a compelling thing to upsell. So probably maybe it's just you have a COM technology that's easier to use, but you need the features. So
that's a wonderful, wonderful question. I'm going to answer that one first, and I'll answer your question. Okay, so there's the idea. This is kind of this is not necessarily a true story, but it's a great urban legend. There was this I forgot her name. Oh, Lucy Suchman at Xerox PARC, who came in and said, "No one can use these printers. There's too many options on them. Why don't you put a button, a big green button on the front that just says print and copy?" And that's not exactly how it went down, but the idea is that most people need to just use that button, that one button, and then there's a bunch of other people that want to tweak all the features. So the idea with COM technology is not to stop giving people choices or make it a completely simplistic thing or remove the command line. It's about exposing these features to people in a COM way. So in the one case, I want to have, you know, I like Windows a lot because I can completely change the experience. But I also like Mac for just getting stuff done really fast. But I want to change everything around. So the number one thing is give people choice. And in kind of an open competitive software world, there will be choices. And then, you know, make for 80% of the people who want it a very simple feature of here's the thing that you want to do, but don't obscure all of those ways to change the system. And of course, it's going to be harder to make a system where you can change all of the things and expose those controls to people, but then you allow people to design the experience they want. Let's say I had a system that said, okay, I'm going to have every time somebody text messages me and I'm in the car, it'll send them a text message back that says I'm driving. Okay, that's interesting for some people. But if it locks me in that way and I can't change the type of alert that I want, then the system is being more controlling of me than it should be, right? So it's, here's a default pattern that you can easily change so that it doesn't like override or make decisions for you. So in the case of a lot of Apple technology, it kind of makes the decision for you about how you'll interact with something. And a lot of people have these blog posts about how to change the default interaction mode on an Apple because they don't like it. And so I think it's important to think about that whole spectrum and give people more choices, but do it in an elegant way. In a computer game, the first level is always about, do these things in a simple way. And then you get all the complexity and all, the bag of extra holding and then more capacity and then more tools, and you learn it over time. And it's the same way with like a lot of this technology where you need to start simple as a wedge and then you can add these features and you just need to add them in a way that doesn't cause people panic. You could put all those extra controls underneath a little flap that you open, and you're like, oh, look, here's the extra controls on a VCR, which some VCRs ended up doing. We're in the same era, again, where people are getting upsold on all these extra features that aren't necessarily useful, and sometimes it's causing people to be terrified because they just need to do the one thing. So thanks for the question. So your question, I think that we should go to Mars because we only have one hard drive for humans right now, and we need to have additional backup hard drives. If this one fails or there's some catastrophic thing that happens, we don't have a backup. So I think it's important to realize that we've always been evolving with technology, and we can't disassociate that. And it's our weird human tendency to say, okay, well, it's the end of the Industrial Revolution, and there's a bunch of horses crapping all over the streets, and we're having a big problem in places like New York and London, and then the Model T Ford comes around and slowly changes that. I think of humans more as like these soft crustaceans that put on like external appendages in the morning and like these exoskeletons to drive places. We're not necessarily that strong in and of ourselves. It's really hard for humans to survive in nature anymore, and it's okay. But it's this symbiotic relationship. So the nicer we are to people through the technology, the better interfaces we make, the easier it's going to be adapt to these new systems. Maybe we should do a conference session on that, but I'm gonna stop.